This year we turn 110. We're fine with growing old. We're not fine with growing stale. So, to celebrate, we're going to throw open the windows and let in some fresh air. We're rethinking and reimagining, and if we find that we've picked up any bad habits over the decades, we're going to leave them far behind. We're simply going to treat people as we'd like to be treated ourselves, fair and square. We won't make anyone jump through hoops to get a good price. We won't fill mailboxes with junk. We'll have great prices every day and spectacular prices that last a whole month. And it won't stop there. We'll keep dreaming up new ways to make you love shopping again, matching our calendar to the rhythm of your life. Because we're not interested in being the biggest store or the flashiest store. We want to be your favorite store.
Good morning. Thank you for coming. Hi, Michael. It's so great to be here. This is the single largest investor day in JCPenney history. And so it's just an honor to all of us who've been working hard that you're so interested to come and hear what we have to say. What you just listened to was a reading of an anthem that we wrote in November. And sometimes it's good to kind of write down your values because they do inform your decisions. And I'd like to start today by pulling out a couple of these. First, we're fine with growing old. We're not fine with growing stale. You know, we love the fact that we're a 110-year-old company, that we were one of the first retailers in this, you know, America, but we want to be young and vibrant. We're rethinking, we're reimagining, and if we find that we've picked up some bad habits through the decades, we're going to leave them far behind. And you'll hear about that today. Because like many of us, over time, we've picked up some bad habits. And we're simply going to treat other people like we like to be treated ourselves, fair and square. And this company was founded, I don't know if you know this, but for the first 10 years, the name of the store was the Golden Rule. And it was 99 years ago that it became JCPenney. And that core value will be a big part of what we do. And ultimately, our goal, we want to be your favorite store. Not the biggest, not the flashiest, but your favorite. And we want to be the favorite store for everyone in this room, for all Americans, rich and poor, young and old, when they want products for their home, for apparel, and more. We want to be their favorite. And this isn't your favorite department store. Our ambitions are much higher. We want to be your favorite store. And so today, we've been working really hard. We're going to share with you the blueprint for how we're going to get there. Now, because of the limitations of time, the limitations of the room, we can't share it all with you. And some we want to keep a little closer to the vest. But when you walk out of here today, you will know exactly where we're headed and why. But before I start, I just have to make a quick comment about this, because I've been asked so many times in the last 8 months, what were you thinking? You know, why would you leave what's now the most valued company in the world to come to JCPenney? And, you know, it's a question that was an interesting one, but it's one that I've been asked many times before. A lot of you don't know me, but back in 1984, I went to Harvard Business School and I was trying to decide what to do. I'd spent the summer at Salomon Brothers, and I said, you know, maybe I want to be in investment banking, but maybe I want to do something different. And I had an offer to join Goldman Sachs M&A Group, which at the time was one of these really coveted, hard to get jobs out of business school. But I had a different idea. I just kind of wanted to do something I could love for a lifetime. And so I took a job with Mervyn's, and as I negotiated, I did pretty well. And they let me, instead of working and starting the back of house, I was got to spend half my time on the floor in the men's department. You know, but I made a decision back in 1984, which is quite a counterintuitive coming out of business school. But I wanted something I could enjoy and love for a lifetime. And that was the first great decision of my life. And then a few years later, you know, I went from Mervyn's to Target, and Target was flourishing. You know, I remember Target became Target through the 90s. And then about 2000, I made another decision, which is I'm going to leave Target to go to Apple. And everyone said, what are you thinking? How could you leave a company like Target, which is just the best in the retail thing, to go to Apple? Apple, a company that back then was losing money with 3% market share. Great heritage, but what are you thinking? Well, that turned out okay. And so kind of here we go again. You know, and so I'm making a decision that some may think is counterintuitive, but I think by the time the day's over, you'll understand exactly why I made this decision. And it's the best decision I've made yet. And the only hard part was that day, I had to drive over to Steve's house. I called him on the phone, I got something I gotta talk to you about. And I had to tell him in his living room that I was gonna leave Apple. And I think his first question, are you serious? But I told him that day, I said, Steve, I feel like this is the exact time at JCPenney as when I joined Apple. And he said, what do you mean? And I said, you know, what I love about Apple when I started was we had 3% market share. 3%. And what did that mean? That if you can keep those three and get one more customer, you grow 33%. And if we can get three more, we double the business. And Apple now has 30% market share in the US in 10, 12 years. But I love the fact that it's 3% market share. Well, Penny's has 3% market share on apparel and home, the products we carry, right? So it's just like Apple. It are just different categories. And to put into perspective how big an opportunity this is, in this room right now, there are 700 people. The 21 of you who are Penny's customers, which is 3%, would fill one row to the middle. All right? So to grow, if we can keep you happy and add two of the rest of you in this room this year, we'll run a 10% same-store increase. Now, if over time I can just fill in the front row and the rest of you keep shopping where you are, we'll double the business. We will be a $30 billion company by simply convincing one row in this room to come to JCPenney. I love those odds. Now, then you look at this. When I joined Apple, we forget. Everyone thinks Apple's been growing for so long. The market cap was $5 billion. JCPenney today is $8 billion. Apple did $5 billion in revenue in 2001. Penny's last year did 18. Apple lost money when I joined Apple. Penny's is profitable, right? And Apple, you know, Steve used to exaggerate a little. He told me we had 25 million customers. Well, that means there were 25 million people using the Mac, and some of those were using Macs from 1984. In the last year plus, 150 million people in America, half the country bought something at Penny's. Now, if you're looking at that, which company would you want to join? I feel really good about being at Penny's. Now, the other interesting thing is that the thing I love, reason number two, I love brands that are a part of history, that have been part of America for a long time. So here's a picture of Steve back in the early 80s when Apple was three, 4 years old, about when the Mac came out. Well, here's a picture of the cover of the Penny's annual report. Isn't that interesting? So about the same time, these two might have known one each other. It looks like they could have been friends. But both companies have been a part of history. But JCPenney goes back a lot longer. Here's a series of annual report covers over the past 40 years that show that we have been part of the fabric of America for a long time. And it's a great fabric. And for the better part of the century, we have flourished. For eight decades, we were kind of king of the retail heap. The last two, we haven't competed quite as well. But just like Apple, we're going to learn that the best days aren't in the rearview mirror, they're right down the road. And I believe, without question, the number one opportunity in American retailing is not the internet, it's not online, it's not discount, it is the department store. And this isn't something I decided last June when I took the job. This is something I've grown to believe for the last 10 to 15 years. Because in my job at Apple, I spent a lot of time in malls. And every time we'd go to a mall to look for a site for an Apple store, where would we park? By the department store, because there weren't as many cars there. And we'd get out of the car and we'd walk through the department stores, and quite frankly, they weren't that crowded. And you get to the middle of the mall and that's where all the customers were, that's where all the people were, right? The world has changed. But every time I'd walk through there, I'd be asking myself, why is this? Why are the department stores not the crowded store? Because back in the good old days, they were. And they've got the bigger store. They've got access to all the merchandise. What's going on? And all the time for a decade, I've been wondering, what is it that has made the department store not the best? And I still think it's the number one opportunity. And I think you all remember the department store in its glory days. This is the department store I went to when I was a kid. This is Southdale Mall in Edina, Minnesota. Southdale, that Dayton store, was the first Dayton suburban store. It was located in the first indoor shopping center in America. And I grew up a 10-minute bike ride from that store. And this store was a huge part of our family's life. When this store opened, everyone in the community came. And I know each of you had one. Each of you had your own department store. Look at these storied names. And these people that built these stores were pillars of the community. They were so proud of these stores, they put their name on these things. These were the institutions that changed their lives. And if you think about going to a department store, it was an unbelievable experience. It's where we went to discover what was new in the world on the product side. When the department store ran a sale, and they were very rare, it was an event. It was like the Nordstrom family today. They still honor price integrity. They run 5 events a year. We all know when they come, and we all go to them. That's what the department store did. It was a place to go with your family, and department stores actually had departments. You know, years ago, you could buy a color TV. I know our family got our first color TV at Dayton's in that store at Southdale. Now, through the years, it's changed. There's been consolidation. The number of department stores has gone down. But at the same time, the world's gotten more complicated. And the truth is, the department store in some ways is lost in the landscape of American retailing. There are a lot of choices. And if you haven't figured out how to stand out, you're not. And the data backs us up. Here's the market share over 20 years for the department store. What was about 60% of all the key categories a department store carries is now about 30, right? But it doesn't have to be that way. It is because of a lot of things that have happened. But I remember when I came to Apple, remember what it was like buying a computer back in the late 90s. You didn't have many choices. In Minneapolis, you had 5. You had 2 Sears stores, 3 Copy USA, and 6, 1 reseller. But we had a different idea at Apple. And in 2001, we launched our first Apple store. No one thought it would work. Nobody thought it would work. Steve and I went to Washington, D.C. We talked to a group of 100 to 200 analysts, and this is what they all said. There wasn't one positive believer that thought an Apple retail store could work. But we all know what happened. Here's the picture of the newest Apple store in New York, you know, over at Grand Central Station. And we have changed, Apple changed the way to buy a computer. And we did that by thinking completely differently about every aspect of the retail business. I mean, you look at that. There's nothing to do in an Apple store but try a product. We even used the Apple product, an iPad, for a digital sign. It's a very different experience. Half the store is devoted to owners. It's not about buying, it's about enriching someone's life at a Genius Bar through personal training. And the Apple stores are now doing over $50 million a year. In fact, the Apple stores last quarter, each store did about the volume that Macy's will do in an entire year, right? So, it doesn't have to be that way. Apple changed the experience of buying the computer, and the customer came. And every Apple product is available everywhere. You can buy them every day on a discount at Amazon. You can buy them at Target at a discount. It's almost like buying gasoline. Every Apple product is everywhere. Yet people like to come to the Apple store, right? So if we're going to transform the department store, we got to start by understanding what happened. How did this institution that was at the king of the hill of American retail get lost in the landscape? And when I was at Harvard Business School, I had the pleasure of learning from Walt Salmon. He's a great professor of business. And he said, you can analyze any retailer, just put up some P's, you know, a little marketing exercise and think about it. Well, if you go back in the day, back in the 60s, the department stores had all the best merchandise, right? And why'd they have that? Because they had the best merchants. If you went into retail, you wanted to get a job at A&S or at Macy's and work in New York, and we all remember that. And because there wasn't data, there were no POS systems and fancy analytical tools, you had to win on the product. And you had to trust your instincts. And department stores had the best products. The department store in the 60s, they were all new, because America went to the suburbs, the mall happened. The department store was the new store in town, right? The department store in the 60s won on presentation. The department store in the 60s won on price because it wasn't competitive on price, right? The department stores won on marketing because they didn't promote their products, they promoted their brand. I remember going downtown to see the Christmas display. I met Santa Claus every year downtown at the 7th floor of the Dayton's department store. They hosted the parades. They were part of the community. Every dollar they spent on promotion elevated their brand. It didn't discount a product. And they had a personality. These stores were the pillar of the community, right? And in retail, what Walt used to say is, if you can do one of these well, you'll probably be profitable. If you get two, you can have an unbelievably good business. And back in the day, the department store was the number one for all of these. But if we look at it today, what's happened? When we want a great product, we go to a specialty store. We might go to J. Crew. We might go to H&M. We might go to Uniqlo, right? If we want home, we go to Williams-Sonoma. We go to the authorities. The department store, rather than, you know, being the first for the products, appears to have a lot of private label. It's almost like we're selling clothing by the pound instead of curating the closet for the customer. So that's not a strength. Our stores are tired. They haven't been updated. We all know this, right? I went through a new Penny store like a month before I started with the team, and it was really well executed. And still I thought, if I shut my eyes and walked through that store, that would have been a great store in 1995. It wasn't a store built for 2025, it was built for 1995. It hasn't been innovative enough. The presentations are tired. The pricing has no integrity. Nothing's bought at regular price. And there's not a single good brand in the world that has a promotional strategy. There's not a high-valued brand in the world with a promotional strategy. We all know that. The promotion doesn't work, and with all of the promoting, the personality's gone away, right? So where we had every strength in the world, we don't win on any now. But it doesn't have to be that way, right? And so the most important thing I want to start with is the pricing strategy. And when I first came to Penny's, I asked to look at some data. And I think you're going to find this very interesting, all right? And I'm actually going to sit down because I don't want to fall down again when I see this. You're all seated. So I'm going to share with you some facts about pricing. And I want to share it with you because it's really important to understand why we're going to change our pricing strategy. An item that cost $10 in 2002 and cost $10 in 2011, here's what's happened to the retail price over the past decade. There's been a 43% increase in the retail price, all right? For a $10 item, we've raised the initial retail. And I was talking to Merv Morris this morning. Merv, you're here. Merv founded the original promotional department store I was here for. Merv, could you stand real quick? Merv told me when he founded Mervin's, they had a 50% markup and that was it. So that $10 item in the original promotional department store would have been $20. A couple decades later, it's 28, and then it was 40. So what do you think the average retail the customer gave us for a product over that period was? It went up 1%. Now, I hope that's because the product was better. But the message here is very clear. The customer knows the right price. We can raise the price all we want. She's only going to pay the right price. And why is that? Because she's an expert. We're all experts. Every time I look at my outfit, I know exactly what I bought, where I bought it, and what I priced, what I paid for it. I know where I got these pants. I know where I got this. I know this. And if you look down, you'll know the same thing. And so to think that you can fool a customer is kind of crazy. All right, so let's look at this a little deeper. Let's look at this. Now, at Penny's, this is the average cost of every item in the store. This is what we pay to buy stuff. This is 10 years. So in 10 years, we've been buying stuff about the same, actually a little lower price. And here's what's happened to our retail price. Or here's what the customer's given us. So the customer clearly is only going to give you what it's worth. But it's been a decade of price increases. And so what happens is you lose track of the fact that we're slowly and slowly increasing prices to a rate that there's no integrity. And so a product that was discounted 38% on average in 2002 is now discounted 60% on average. This is every item in the store for someone to buy it, right? And what we really haven't realized is we're not discounting the product. Every time we do it, we're discounting our brand. We're chipping away at our Penny's brand because the customers don't like brands they can't trust. Trust is the core value of a brand, right? And this is another last bit of data that I want to share with you. This shows for last year, for an entire year, the average, the percentage of goods bought at various discount rates, all right? So you'll see here, nothing was bought at regular price. Fewer than 1 out of 500 units. 1 was bought at 20% off. 8 was bought at 30. The customer doesn't even pay attention until 40% off. In fact, if you look at the total, 72% of the revenue, 3/4 of everything sold in the store was at a 50% off or greater discount. Now that's gotta be surprising. That was surprising to me. Because I knew when I was at Mervyn's, when we started, we had rules. You could only be on sale 1 week out of the month. Because there was honor to the regular retail. Well, with this kind of thing, what do you expect the customer to do? Now, this is the industry. I'm sharing Penny's data, but my guess is one of the core competitors actually sells more at a greater discount and one a little bit less. But we all have the same margin, the same price points at regular, so it has to be this way, right? Now, what's interesting, if you look at this data, the real powerful conclusion that I see here is the following. 75% of the time, it's in a 20% price band. The far right, that's clearance. You got to clear goods, that goes away. There's very little bits sold below 40. But the customer's willing to have a range on prices. Sometimes they just want the convenience of buying it today. So it's not like there's one price, but there's a range of prices where the customer loves to shop. And the conclusion from all of this to me is very simple. She knows the right price. And if you don't trust your customer, that's a major gap in a relationship that starts before you really get her in the door, all right? Now, the problem I see as well, as we talked about those P's, one P that has a problem like pricing, when you have a disease, it starts to grow. And it infects other parts of your life. It happens in our personal lives. When we have a problem in one part of our life, it affects another. It's also true with companies. So when I came to Penny's, I said, well, I've got about 6 months, 5 months till I start. If I sign up for the email, you know, I should get about an email a week, which will let me keep track of what's going on, because I was still easing out of Apple as I eased into Penny's. And I signed up, and I got an email right away. And I got one the next day, and the next day, and the next day, and the next day. And every day I got emails, right? And it was interesting. Each one was a different offer. I saw weekly events. I saw weekend-only events, like daily-only, like a one-day sale. I saw in-store events, online-only. I started to keep track of these things. You know, department-specific, jewelry, home, shoes. And then there were these things called hourly bonus buys that, you know, if that's not good enough, if you come in between 10 and 12, you get an even better value. And then I saw extra percent off that. You know, sometimes the whole circular was done. You'd see something like, save an extra 20% today. And then I saw there were some coupons that came from manufacturers and some we created ourselves. And then I discovered this thing called JCP Cash. And you know, you can actually earn cash by buying something at a discount that you can use when you come back later. I still don't really understand it, but it's something that we do. We have credit card offers. That's not just to get a credit card, that's special value if you have a credit card, like a JCP card. We have loyalty programs that don't earn loyalty, You earn loyalty through a relationship. It's earned through discounts. We do clearance sales. We do free shipping, sometimes, not all the times, sometimes under $50, sometimes over. And this is just some of the email I received. Now, as a customer, you gotta be wondering, how do I know when the right time to buy is? It's pretty confusing. And she's already told us there's a price I'd like to pay. So we mark these goods up to here, we spend all this time doing that, and does she pay attention? Well, I went to a meeting as part of my getting acclimated pennies, and I was in a meeting with all the merchants and the advertising teams, and on the wall were last week's circular. And I thought it looked like a season's worth of circulars. And I asked, how many events did we run last week? And they said 11. 11 last week, okay? How many did we run in a year? Well, it turns out last year we did 590 unique promotions, 1 year. Now again, we're not the only one doing this. This is the industry. This is how competition prevails. What was our average number of visits? 4. So how many times did the customer ignore us? 99% of the time. Now this is, Steve would have called this insanity. You know, I learned this in eighth grade when I'd call that girl and I wanted her to call me back. If she didn't say, yes 3 or 4 times, I knew it was time to stop. You know, at some point, you as a brand look desperate. If you have to market that much, you don't believe in your product. And if you don't convey conviction or belief, why would the customer believe in it? Make sense? Well, how much did we spend last year getting ignored? JCPenney spent over $1 billion and the customer didn't even pay attention. And every dollar was a discount to a product, which I view as a discount to a brand. And that's just not a good way to use money. And it clearly doesn't work, right? So we've now got a problem in our pricing strategy, which has created a problem in our promotional strategy, right? And we decided that we're gonna make an ad that ran this morning that's gonna let the customer, it's gonna reflect what I really think she's telling us. And I'll play that for you quickly. Now, in my heart of hearts, I don't think we realize this, but just like, America doesn't trust Wall Street, America has concerns about government's ability to solve problems, I think we're part of that. There's a fundamental fairness, integrity issue that's going on, and the customer is rejecting us because of that. And so we're gonna change it. And like I said, a disease in your pricing causes a disease everywhere. Promotion, we just talked about. I won't go into detail, but the products. A real brand wouldn't let us market their products because they don't want to be discounted 50% off. When you don't have a good profit formula, you can't afford to update your presentation. When you don't have a good profit formula, you can't create new stores. And eventually, the personal of the brand becomes about a promotion. Make sense? So this is what's happened to the industry, in my opinion, and we are a big part of it, but we are not alone, right? So we thought about it, we got a lot of work to do, right? We gotta fix all these things. But we determined that 3 of these, if we had courage, if we were willing to be bold, we could change like this. And so we are gonna fix our pricing, our promotion, and get an all new personality next week on February 1st, all right? Let me tell you about it. Okay, what are we gonna do on price? Well, we're gonna call it fair and square, right? We'll have 3 types of prices, that's all. Nothing complicated, nothing tricky, 3 prices. We're gonna have everyday prices, which will always be great. And we'll set those exactly where she likes to start buying. But clearly, I do not believe in an everyday low pricing strategy. There's no evidence that that works in the US and we're in a very competitive environment. So instead of putting items on sale for an hour or a day or a week, We're going to give the customer an entire month to come in and shop on her terms. So we'll have great everyday prices, but we'll also have even better prices on the things she needs that will last an entire month. Now, they won't be as big a discounts, but they'll be in that range where she loves to buy. Because she knows the right price, you just want to give her the right price when it's time for her to buy. And our third type of price will be this, our best price. We are eliminating clearance from JCPenney because the truth is the product hasn't changed. We just got to make room for the new stuff. And so we're going to offer our lowest prices, always happen on the first and third Fridays of every month while they last. So three types of prices. That's it. Simple, honest, fair, and square. That's our commitment to the customer. And we're going to work really hard to communicate this. But we think it's going to let her shop on her terms and have every day be a great day to shop, yet we'll have a better value strategy than our competitors because it lasts for an entire month. All right? Now, how do we know where to set the prices? Well, it's actually pretty easy, and the teams down in Plano have repriced every item of the store based exactly on where she told us. Because we know exactly what price she likes to pay for every item because we've got the history, right? So let me give you three examples, okay? This towel last year, it's one of our core high-volume towels. We had a retail price of $10. By the time all the sales happened, every week, and all the discounts and coupons, it actually went out the door for about $3.30. It's kind of a surprise. Next year, this spring, tomorrow, next week, $4. That's the everyday price of that towel. When it's time to change a color, we go to $2. And I guarantee this merchandise will move fast. Now, it's opened up for our merchants. You know, they thought, well, we carry $10 towels. The truth is we only carry $4 towels, right? So we have got to now upgrade our assortments. And boy, are the teams at work, but with our new pricing strategy, we'll have $4 towels, $7, $10 towels, and we are going to dramatically improve the content at JCPenney. Because like everything, you think you're pricing something here, you're really not. Let's look at another item. This is a woman's core volume. The t-shirt is in the picture in the middle there. Last year, we retailed these at $14. They actually went out the door closer to six. Right, so this year, next week, $7. Now, when this is on a month-long value during May, when someone really needs t-shirts, we'll be at $5. When it's time to move a color, we'll be at $4. But every day will be a great day to shop because every product in the store is priced exactly where she likes to buy. Make sense? One more. Here's a fashion shoe. Last year, this shoe would have been $40. This year, it'll be $30. Month-long value, $22. Time to go away, $15. Straightforward, fair and square, everyday prices. No 99-cent innings, even price points. As if a penny matters to anybody today, you know, fair and square. Now, because we're changing our pricing, we now can change our promotion. And as I said last year we ran 590. We love promotions, but we like the way Nordstrom does it. If you do 5 a year, everyone knows they come, it's an event, it's a really meaningful thing. So we're gonna reduce the number a little bit so we can do these exceptionally well. And we're going to do 12. 590 to 12. And you know what they are? They're called months. Pretty straightforward, right? The customer lives in a cycle. We all do this. We always have. August is what? Back to school. Every year, parents come back from vacation. It's all about getting kids ready for the school. So why not let them know on August 1st what the values are for the month and have the best price all August on the things she needs for her kids. It just makes sense. And let her shop when it's convenient for her, not when it's expedient for us. What if she's out of town when the denim was on sale? That's not fair, right? That's just common sense. In November, everyone forever has gotten ready for the holidays. That's when they think about food prep and they get their Christmas tree. This doesn't change. So in November, we ought to be talking about those things. December's gift, January, New Year. This doesn't have to be so complicated. So we're going to run 12 events. Now, last year, We spent $2 million on average on every promotion we did. It's a little money, but they didn't come in. How much are we going to spend trying to get the customer to come in every month? $80 million. And we're going to show you it in a second. We are going to put $80 million against the month. Now, to put this in perspective, when I worked with Steve at Apple, during the first 5 years when Apple really rolled out the iPod, it was before the phone, you know, I think we all knew those silhouette ads, right? We all heard the music. Apple spent $50 million a quarter worldwide marketing iPods. We're going to spend $80 million a month in the US to try to get someone to pay attention. And you'll see the advertising. It's a lot of money, but it's going to work. And the very simple goal is this. Instead of having the customer come four times a year, we'd like her to come once a month. Now, if we can succeed in that, we would triple our business. This is a very big opportunity. And nobody in retail has ever owned a month. You know, there are people that owned a week. There are people that, you know, but we're going to own the idea of a month. And we're going to get our entire company in sync with the rhythm of a customer's life, right? So now we've got a new pricing strategy. We've got a new promotional cadence. And that's going to let us change our personality. Because these things are so profound, we thought it was time to update and modernize our brand. And so I'd like to take a break here and have Michael Francis come up and share with you where the brand's going and how we're going to communicate our pricing and our promotion to the customer. So please welcome Michael Francis.
Thanks, Ron. Good morning, everyone. Well, I'm excited to share with you a number of the steps we've taken to update the personality of JCPenney and then walk you through some of the other changes underway beginning on 2/1/12. As Ron said, with the transactional nature of our relationship with consumers over the past decade, we've really walked away from investing in the JCPenney brand. And this is a remarkable opportunity for us to reintroduce ourselves to those customers who love us today and to welcome new customers to JCPenney. But we really wanted to start by taking a holistic view of where we were as a brand and the opportunity that we saw to freshen JCPenney for a whole new generation. We really took a step back and said, you know, what is a brand? We believe at JCPenney that a brand is a living asset. It's got to be brought to life across every possible touch point. And if we do our job well and we properly manage it, we know that it'll create identification, differentiation, and it'll drive loyalty. Now, we're all familiar with iconic brand marks. There are many of them out there, familiar to all of us, because they've been well managed over time, they've been imbued with meaning, and they stand for something powerful. Retail iconic marks have really been the exception. When you think about it, there are a lot of very strong and familiar names. Most of them expressed as word marks. Over time, elements have been added, but that really is the reality of most of the retail brands today. We decided that there really had to be a different opportunity. We took a look at our JCPenney brand mark. It's interesting, we went back into history, we went through the archives, and we really looked at the development of the JCPenney name and what's been done with it. It was fascinating to see that it's often been boxed in. And as we looked at it, and we looked at the evolution, a couple years ago, this concept was launched, JCPenney, with the JCP in a box, and ultimately the vision here was to freshen it over time to simply be JCP. That certainly contemporized the brand. It certainly freshened things up. We didn't believe it went far enough. As we really looked at the legacy of the brand mark, and we looked at its iconic nature, one thing emerged. Through it all, the box had been present. We chose to look at it differently. What we saw emerge was really a frame. And frames frame the things we love. And we thought there was something powerful here, something that we could really develop and to use. Now, as we thought about that mark, we thought about that frame, we thought, well, we thought about our current logo, we thought, well, we have a starting point here from a new perspective. It's probably not enough, because other retailers have done something similar, where they've created a box or a frame around their name. But we knew that if we really wanted to be America's favorite store, we wanted to move into something that really telegraphed that view. And so with that, we were able to leverage our heritage, but to freshen to a new brand mark for JCPenney, which will launch on 2/1/12. And we love this mark because it allows us to stand out, and it allows us to create a more impactful, iconic look for the brand. And we love it because it works hard as well. It allows us to leverage the mark as a frame for customers to see a different JCPenney, whether it's small towns or big cities, whether we use it to capture a seasonal moment, or simply use it to frame great product and to celebrate product on a regular basis. So the use of this system, as we look at our creative and we release new creative to the world, allows us to come in tight and talk about great brand names, whether private or national. It allows us to talk about our everyday pricing, talks about our month-long value and our new fair and square price philosophy. So this becomes one element of the new personality. Beyond that, we wanted to look at the way we intend to communicate and how we want to unite all of our consumer-facing messaging. There are several attributes that we're focused on: honesty, simplicity, being relevant to customers. That Duran's point about having this system by really focusing in on the month, and to inspire. And as we looked at shaping our new voice and the new face of the brand, we also saw an opportunity to be distinctly American. One of our influences was really looking at the classic Saturday Evening Post. Warm, inspiring in many ways, truly American, and we thought there was a tonality here and a personality that we loved, and we thought it was a fresh way for us to engage our customers. So as we move forward, we were inspired to think of ways that we could reach our customers in a very different way, in a very fresh way, and have a little fun, showcase great product, talk about our months, and to do so in a very differentiated way. So that begins to give shape to the personality of the JCPenney of the future. And another important way that we want to introduce the new JCPenney brand is through partners. We've enjoyed great partnerships with designers, with our national brand partners over time. And as we set forth with this new vision, there was one person who we really thought could help us convey the essence of the new JCPenney in a powerful way. Someone who is so highly regarded and beloved by audiences throughout the country and around the world that we thought there's a powerful way for us to amplify our messaging. So we're excited to announce today our partnership with Ellen DeGeneres. She couldn't be here today, but she did send along this video.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you very, thank you. This is awkward. I don't know if people are still applauding or not, but thank you very much. Fine, I'll wait. Oh, thank you. Please, sit down, everyone. That was too much. Thank you. Thank you. I am very excited to be working with JCPenney. One of my first jobs was at JCPenney in Metairie, Louisiana, back in 19... when I was... Now, I would tell you when it was, but I don't remember. It was the 70s and everything's a blur. Anyway, I'm excited about this partnership, and I know how you corporate people are. You love your charts and your graphs and your TCP reports and your quarterly, annual profit margarines. So I put together a little presentation for you. First of all, it's important to point out that we share the same values. Honesty, simplicity, respect, and designated parking spots for motorcycles so you don't pull up to what you think is an empty spot only to find a stupid motorcycle parked in it. Isn't that the worst? Ugh! Anyway, JCPenney is going to reposition itself
That's just a picture of a baby polar bear. It's got nothing to do with this. It's just so cute. I had to put it in there because it's just adorable. Look at that thing. But they're vicious, so be careful. Anyway, JCPenney is going to reposition itself as one of America's favorite brands in many, 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 many different ways. One way is by launching a brand new ad campaign. We just shot 5 commercials. Not only did we shoot them, they are going to air on television. My idea. And the commercials are like nothing you've ever seen before. At one point, I'm wearing a dress. You'll see. I'm excited about this partnership. And I'm excited to tell everybody about this partnership. I'm going to talk about JCPenney on my show. I'm going to talk about it to the people in line behind me at Starbucks. The only place I won't talk about it is at the movies, because that's rude. That's when I'm going to text about it. We're going to do some amazing things together. And we're going to have a whole lot of fun. I love that after 110 years, JCPenney is reinventing themselves. I believe in change. If I never changed, I'd be standing here talking to you today with a mullet. JCP and ELLEN are back together again to celebrate the great American department store. I promise you it's going to be great and American, and there will be departments. Thank you, and back to you, Michael.
We simply couldn't think of a better partner, and this will be launched today on Ellen's show, and we have been working with Ellen and her talented team as we map out an exciting strategy that'll take us through this year and beyond, and we're thrilled to have her join us as a partner. Now, Ron talked about our pricing changes, and this is the enabler of so many other great things to come. Clearly, this represents change, and we're going to have to educate our customers. So the ongoing marketing around our price change is going to be one of the bedrock elements of this next year. Our fair and square pricing will be communicated with great vigor in all of our communications. This is an example of an ad. This will appear in all forms of media, and there are many other elements to this as we continue to communicate what fair and square pricing means and how it's going to be positioned for our customers. One of the things that we also want to do is to adjust our media mix. You know, television has been something that's been largely relegated to only the endless drumbeat of promotional activity. We have an opportunity here to better leverage that medium, to tell our story, and to communicate the changes underway. I'd like to give you an example of some of the work that we've developed. This next example is a spot that we'll be beginning in the month of February, all designed around communicating fair and square pricing and the changes underway. Once again, we are trying to be warm, inviting, fresh, and something that's really quite different from what customers are seeing from retailers today. Beyond that, all of our communications will allow us to showcase our pricing. We'll be able to hit on our great everyday pricing. We'll expose our month-long values. And we'll be able to feature in our best price on the first and third Fridays. We'll drive this across all channels, whether through our digital platform, our website, our mobile platform. And each month, we'll be able to freshen this look, and we'll be able to ensure that we have the right focus on communicating our new pricing strategy and establish fair and square for consumers. Additional work will debut in February. Here's another spot meant to underscore the change underway.
85, now it'll be at 85, now it'll be at 85, now it'll be at 75. At 75, now it'll be at 75, now it'll be at 75, now it'll be at 65, now it'll be at 65, now it'll be at 65. 65, now it'll be at 80, now it'll be at 65, now it'll be at, sir, can you go lower? 65, now it'll be at 55. 55, now it'll be at 55, ma'am, yeah, 55, now it'll be at, can you go lower? 55, 55, now it'll be at 45. 45, got 45 right there, thank you, sir. 45, now it'll be at 35. At 35, now it'll be at 35. How about it, ma'am? 35, I got 35, now it'll be at 35. Now it'll be at 20, now it'll be at 20, got 20, yes, 20. Now it'll be at 20, and $20, and I'm going to get 20, and I stole $20.
Beyond communicating fair and square pricing, We also have an opportunity to change our return policy. This will be another element that we'll launch on 2/1/12. One happy return policy, any item, anytime, anywhere, it's that simple. Once again, making it easy for our customers, taking some of the work out of shopping and restoring the joy. We'll be communicating this through an additional television spot. As we move into our first and third Friday, we know we have an opportunity to really celebrate these events and to make them meaningful. So first and third Friday, our best price Friday, will be communicated boldly through all media channels. This example is a post-it note that'll be on the front page of 21 newspapers throughout the country. We'll also communicate this through an aggressive direct mail program, as well as through all of our digital channels. This too will be supported through broadcast. Best Price Friday is something we really believe will build equity in over time and support it through an immense promotional strategy across the medium spectrum. Promotion, with pricing in hand, with tools underway to communicate our new fair and square pricing philosophy to our customers, we now want to tackle promotion. You know, as Ron said, when you spend $1 billion plus on this, and you don't necessarily convince your customers that it's either compelling or interesting, we really felt we had an opportunity to capture their imagination on this monthly basis. So owning the month is a significant opportunity for us. We started by giving personality to each of the months. So this represents kind of the creative tone that we'll be setting beginning in February and driving through the year. Each month has been given an identity. And beyond this warm and inviting and humorous and American-looking creative toolbox, we've also been able to establish a color palette for every month. This is based on trend, it's based on input from our partners, and it allows us to frame up, if you will, our proposition for each month as we not only develop our marketing, but as you'll see in a few minutes, energize our stores. One of the first elements that we'll be introducing beginning on 2/1/12 is what we're calling our book. This is going to be one of the critical elements, and this will continue to unfold as we get into the season. This is a flavor for the first couple of months of the calendar year. These will set the table for each month. I'll speak about them in just a moment. The beauty of the month is that we've now allowed our sales associates, those JCPenney team members who've been so focused on service but also trying to endlessly reset our selling floor and re-ticket items, we now will set the table at the beginning of the month. The consumer's month, not a retail calendar or an accounting calendar, but the beginning of the month across every channel, whether online or in our stores. So we'll transform the store as we set it visually, as we set it from a product standpoint, as we begin to release marketing. Now, we know that in any given month, there are those events which retailers focus on. In the month of February, for example, we know we have Valentine's Day. It's also the Super Bowl. It's the Oscars. Those often become great retail moments. But it can go much more deeply, and we can be much better aligned with consumers when we start to look at other data. Data which reveals, for example, that February is also the month that most Americans entertain in their home, or the month where most Americans make a discretionary purchase in decorative home as they're taking down holiday trim and preparing to put the house back together. Small examples, but a rich vein to mine from a merchandising organization who's now been freed from backing in their assortments into the endless stream of promotions and can really focus on building wonderful assortments that align with consumer expectations. So setting the table for every month, one of the things we want to do is invite the customer in and allow her to understand how it is we've curated our stores to reflect her needs and to reflect her life. One of the ways we'll do that is through broadcast.
The snow is snowing, the wind is blowing, but I can weather the storm. What do I care how much it may storm? I've got my love to keep me warm.
Each month, anthemic work will debut, which frames up the season. It'll allow us to run that through the entire month, and it really will be paid off in a variety of other media tools. I referenced the book. This is an example of the way that we're going to communicate our new strategy and to re-engage our customers and cause them to fall back in love with product again. With the new pricing strategy in hand, each and every month, this 96-page book will drop into consumer mailboxes. Fascinating, this book for February represents the product that our merchants had already purchased. So when we talk about making changes quickly, this didn't require us to reassort our store. All it did was require us to free ourselves from the constant promotion and to really focus in on trend-right, well-priced product. So this will be sent out each and every month, allowing us to talk about the seasons, allowing us to talk about new trends, and really giving our customers a reason to make that additional visit, and another reason to keep JCPenney top of mind. Beyond this cornerstone vehicle, we also have taken a fresh look at our Sunday preprints. Certainly a tool that we're all familiar with, but here too, this has become largely promotional and transactional. We intend to have the best preprint in the business. Great paper, great quality, and it allows us to break the month down into segments where we can go deeper into various categories. So for example, in the first week of February, Fickle February, we'll be able to talk about fashion transition and to shine a brighter light on key fashion items of the season. As we move through each book, we'll add additional pages from the month-long book and allow us to really go more deeply when it makes sense. So for example, as we move into week two for Valentine's Day, we'll be able to dial up the energy around critical businesses like intimate apparel, cosmetics, and fine jewelry. We've designed this in a manner that is less the retail formula. We want to be able to present the product in a compelling way that is not based on the bundling of pages by category, but rather inspires shopping. It inspires cross-shopping. It draws you through the store and through the book in a unique way. It tells stories. It's much more editorial in its focus. As we come toward the end of the month, as people are heading off on family vacations or spring break, we'll help them with that as well. Whether it's through the exposure of luggage and tips on packing to the right looks for winter getaways. This look will drive beyond the book. You know, I should point out that the Sunday preprints will be inserted to the tune of 27 million on those Sundays. So we have another opportunity to cast a large net to communicate our pricing strategy and to expose our consumers and our existing JCPenney customers to this great new product. Beyond that, we're freshening up our entire digital platform. So beginning in February, this too will be organized around the month. We'll be launching our new iPad application. And beyond that, we're launching a mobile platform for both iPhones as well as Android. I talked a little bit earlier about the color being changed out every month. You certainly saw the use of pink, for example, in February reflected through the book and through the circulars. Another thing it does is it allows us to transform our stores. Where so much visual presentation has been focused only on holiday, by moving toward a monthly cadence, we can energize our stores each and every month. So for example, the exterior lighting will change on our stores for each of the months as we move through the calendar year. We'll make it known that something fresh and new is happening at JCPenney. Visual presentation is critical. We know we have an opportunity as we look at our stores to create greater impact. So every month, every store will go through a radical transformation where we're able to create that same impact with our new look, with new color, at all of our major entrances. And this too will pulse by month as we freshen our marketing, as we utilize our color palette, and we create great energy throughout the store. When you look at our main aisles, you know, these have been, this is an area for us to really communicate newness underway as it relates to our assortments. You know, one of the things we want to do is to use that frame, to frame great product by month. And once again, through various strike points through all our stores, express the new JCPenney. And I think this is particularly telling. This is a shot today when you see the chaos of all the promotional signing and the headers and the toppers, and you're really not quite sure where you want to look, if you want to look. The opportunity here is to streamline this, to clean this up, and to really create excitement, lower the size of the fixturing, edit the assortments, utilize better visual merchandising standards, and create great visual excitement that we can, again, change each and every month. And a final example, just utilizing the racetrack in a very different way so that all those key punctuation points throughout the store, our consumers know that something new is happening. Another reason to come into the end of the mall to experience what's in store at JCPenney. And all of this will begin on 2/1/2012 in all of our JCPenney stores. Now I'd like to invite Ron back up, and we'll get into the next segment on presentation.
Thank you, Michael. You know, I personally just love the work that Michael and the teams have done. And it's interesting to note that the same people that produced the chaos you walked through in the last 90 days have produced all of the art you've seen here. You know, same team, same people, a little different direction. I'm really proud of them. Now, I think what Michael's conveyed is we're going to have a very different pricing strategy on next week, different promotional cadence, a different personality, and the store is going to look really different. If you've been to our store here in Manhattan, you'll see it already. It is cleaned up, and the customers will notice improvement. But long term, that is not going to create America's favorite store. We have to radically rethink presentation because the retail industry is very tired on how we present merchandise, right? So what do we know? Well, there's one fundamental element that came out from the data, the market share, who won the last 20 years? Specialty stores, right? So what do you know? Shops work. Customers like to buy in edited, curated environments. And in the age of the internet, where you're one keyword search away from the exact product you want, our tolerance for complexity has gone to nothing. And so the idea of walking in a big store with endless sea of racks is just not what the customer wants today. And we know that too because we've got two shops at JCPenney. Mike and the teams over the last few years developed a great partnership with Mango, you know, from Barcelona, and we present the merchandise in the shop. Sephora has been inside JCPenney now for 5 years, and the customer loves to shop Sephora at JCPenney. Now, this is an incredible data. Everything in Sephora has been sold at regular price for the last 5 years because Sephora is a brand that people come to, right? It's all about great product, and every day is a great day to buy. So in the midst of all that promotion going on at JCPenney, the sales per square foot at the JCPenney Sephora stores are $600. Now the entire store does $200 on average. This is pretty interesting, isn't it? So the customer figured out how to buy Sephora at JCPenney, even though the rest of the store was operating at a different pricing cadence. It clearly shows the value of merchandising by shops, where you edit and create environments. So, should play with shops. But the other interesting thing I discovered when I went back to Penny's is the fixtures we use throughout the store are the same fixtures I used to merchandise at Mervyn's in 1984. Now, I spent 6 months of my life every morning taking the men's department and sizing and filling in and changing every rack. And the core workhorse racks in retail were the round rack, the four-way, and the T-stand. And it hasn't changed. Isn't that interesting? 30 years, the same fixtures. So we said, there's a challenge. Fixtures can be expensive. How do we solve? How do you improve presentation? Well, we decided, let's think of it as a design opportunity. You know, there's reasons people use fixtures because they work. But maybe there's a way to design your way to a better solution. So we asked the question, what if we could create one new fixture and transform JCPenney? That'd be a pretty good outcome. So we've done it. Let me show you it. There it is. What do you think? I'm kidding. This is a 5 by 5 foot fixture. Well, it's interesting. You put two of these together, you have a tall fixture. Now we got some height in the floor. And you connect these, and what do you have? A wall. That's one fixture. Used, connected. Now, if you look at that, we can go engineer that really inexpensively. Retailers like us don't like walls because they consume too much inventory and they're hard to maintain. But we're going to look at walls as our friend because they're the backdrop to shops. Now, if you take the capacity of that wall, that equals the same retail capacity as all the floor in front of it. So by putting in walls, we can tell stories, and we don't have to be so dense on the floor. Isn't that interesting? So what do you do with a wall? Well, you put in some graphics. It's storytelling. It's very inexpensive. And then you put some products on. And then because you've got so much inventory presented in interesting ways, you can lighten up the floor. And we have a shop with one fixture. Now, if you want to go a little better, you put a little glass on the corner, you drop a ceiling, and the shop gets better and better and better. Now, that's a very different looking environment than we have today. So we like shops. It works for home, too. Imagine walking into a home department. You can fill the wall with all the towels and lighten up with things in front of it. One fixture, we can move to shops. So what are we going to do? We are going to transform JCPenney, the entire store, month by month, shop by shop. We have two today. Starting August 1st of this year, we will begin an exercise to add two or three shops each and every month for the next 3.5 years until the entire store, every store, is merchandising shops. All right? And when we're done in 2015, our stores will have 100 unique shops, which will totally transform the way the customer experiences the store. Now, this is like turning retail on its head, because what do retailers do today? We go remodel a store. And we do 1 out of 1,000 stores, and it's good for the one, but what about the 999? Every one of our stores will improve month by month at the same time. And the momentum of the shops will be noticed by the customer. And as you've seen today, we've got great marketing materials to tell about a new shop. So when we launch something new, everyone's going to know. And when we do this month after month after month, we believe that customers will start to wonder, I wonder what the new merchandise attraction will be at JCPenney next month. So now that we're working in the month cycle, we add new concepts every month, right? Some can be a variety of shops, but it's all part of the magic of making the month matter, which is all enabled by the pricing, which is all supported by the marketing, which now moves into the presentation. When we're done, instead of 400 unique brands, we have 100 shops. It's interesting, right? Now, once you solve the presentation problem, it creates an extraordinary opportunity because it lets us change our products. Because now that we can present things so well and everything doesn't have to be merchandised by sleeves on shoulders, we can get more interesting merchandise. And so our teams have been running really hard to update the content at JCPenney. And it's been unbelievably liberating. For the last decade, about 50% of the time that the buyers spend is pricing merchandise, preparing for ads. They had a choice, go home Wednesday noon or work on product the rest of the week. So everyone at Penny's now is working to transform products. And what's been exceptionally delightful to Michael and I is how quickly the merchants are doing amazing work. The store will look better next week through how we present and a lot of the merchandise. But they're moving as quick as the marketing team did to update our brand. And when you see next fall, you will be blown away by the content. And I'd like Michael to take you through a little bit of that, if you could.
Great. One of the first things you're going to notice when you walk into our stores in February is a dramatic editing of content. Literally tens of thousands of fixtures will be taken off the floor. We're eliminating non-productive brands. We're restoring integrity to some of those private brands that our consumers have loved most. And we're deeply into design review for not just the third quarter, but inventory that'll be rolling into our stores late in the second quarter and into the third quarter. So now that our merchants and our design teams and our sourcing teams are all focused on improving the quality of our product and restoring the brand integrity of some of these private brands, which have been meaningful to consumers, I'd just like to share a couple examples with you. One of those first shops that we'll be introducing is a repositioned Worthington shop. Clearly a well-loved brand at JCPenney. But the merchants and the design team have been freed and have done remarkable work taking this brand forward, restoring trend, bringing great quality attributes back into the product, and we have built off what we already know is the resonance of this product with our current JCPenney guests and believe that its repositioning is going to enable us to reach new guests. Beyond that, St. John Bay, another well-loved brand at JCPenney, but one that's been frankly allowed to creep too broadly, being repositioned, being reconceived. These are just examples of the workrooms that the teams have created at our headquarters, where they're testing new concepts, and they're looking at quality, and they're looking at brand attributes, and they're ensuring that there's integrity around these private brands, that they're meaningful, so that as we build these shops, we know that they're going to stand apart and freshen our store experience and our assortments. Categories like our Stafford collection. You know, this has been an opportunity to once again free the team to think about bringing trend back into our tailored business. You know, these are items now that will roll into all stores, where in the past we may have held back and only gone for basics. We want to have that same quality trend perspective driven across the chain and ensure that we're reaching all of our customers in towns large and small with the same quality, the same taste level, and the same degree of trend. And another example that you'll be seeing roll out in the next couple of quarters is our repositioned JF collection, our J4R collection. Here too, dramatic change underway in terms of quality and in terms of trend as we introduce, reposition this brand throughout all of our JCPenney stores. So it gives you a flavor for some of the things underway as we track toward a vision of a store of shops and we begin the process of really identifying the partners and the brands that are going to help us transform the experience and ultimately transform our entire assortment. This gives you a little flavor for things you're going to see immediately.
I wish for all of us we could show you in some way what these shops are going to feel like, because it will truly transform our store, but it's hard in a room like this, isn't it?
I think it is, but I think we can give a little flavor of that.
Okay.
I'd like to go ahead and...
Thank you, Michael. That was good.
This gives us... This is meant to just give you a flavor of some of the shop concepts that are actively in development today, things that you're going to see roll out to all of our stores in the coming months. And we'd like to spend a little bit of time walking you through some of the various vignettes that we've just revealed. I'm going to start on the right here with Liz Claiborne. You know, with our acquisition of Liz Claiborne, we have an opportunity to take one of the one of our top performing lines within ready-to-wear and dramatically reposition it and restore the integrity to a great iconic American brand. We've already introduced activewear. By fall, we'll be rolling out career. We'll be driving this through men's and through women's and creating shops which allow us to unite product for the first time, including satellite collections of accessories and shoes to allow our core JCPenney customer who loves this brand to experience it in an entirely different way and to be inspired with each and every visit. This shop will roll out to 600 plus stores beginning in August of 2012.
Thank you, Michael. The photo. Another shop that we'll be rolling out, and as you look around the room, if you can take a quick peek, you notice that these little vignettes are the exact width of our column. So when you think of walking, pretend you're in the aisle at JCPenney, each of these would be the size of the smallest shop. Some shops will take up two column bays. They would be twice as big. These are meaningful ways to edit the assortment and have impact. But we are so excited to introduce in the little booth on the left that Nanette Lepore will be joining the JCPenney team next year. And Nanette is creating an exclusive line for us, L'Amour Nanette Lepore. And it's really driven by the relationship she has with her 14-year-old daughter. And Nanette has done amazing work, you know, in the contemporary area with flirty, feminine, unbelievable sportswear styles. But we all know they're a little too expensive for juniors. And the styles might be a little too sophisticated. What if you could add a little more fun and really add the kind of embellishment and details that younger girls like? And so she'll be launching a line next spring, actively working designing, that will be one of the new shops at JCPenney. And we're thrilled to have Nanette on the team. So thank you.
Arizona Jeans has been part of the JCPenney assortment for more than 20 years. Kind of American staples, basics, quality, fashion goods for families. This brand is going to go through a dramatic transformation this year with new finishes, new quality attributes, really taking a look at unleashing the talents of our merchandising and design teams and creating a remarkable, inspired collection of product for everyone in the family. Arizona Jean Shops will be launched in all JCPenney stores in fall of 2012 and have an aggressive marketing campaign as we move forward in repositioning the Arizona collection.
And just to let you know, these are a smattering of shops under development. We actually have 30 unique shops actively in development today, and we're just trying to convey to you the types of things they'll be. You know, we have a lot of great partners, like Phillips Van Heusen. One of the great classic American brands for years has been Izod. It's been a part of our sportswear lifestyle for 75 years. It's active, it's outgoing, it's golf, it's everything, and we'll be rolling out Izod shops this fall in all of our stores. And we think it's going to create the best place in America to buy Izod, which is one of America's favorite brands. Because while Izod is broadly distributed, and that's a wonderful thing, the way you compete is you curate, you carry better products, you create a better shopping environment. And we think the combination of a wonderful shopping environment with a great partner like Phillips Van Heusen, with great pricing that'll include good everyday prices and month-long values, we will become America's place to buy Izod. So this shop will roll out in the fall.
And I think this vignette on my right speaks to the fact that while we've identified 10 shops that we've named that will be rolling out this fall, while we have multiple brands like L'Amour and Lepore that we've identified for 2013, the teams have literally been scouring the globe and working with their markets over the course of the last 90 days and developing a whole new series of concepts that will be introduced to JCPenney over the coming years. So you can expect to hear from us with great regularity as we introduce these concepts and we prepare to go to market. And that'll ensure that our stores are endlessly refreshed and that we constantly have new news to share.
Thank you, Michael. And let's talk about one more real quickly. And I'll use this one, we'll talk a little longer because shops are good, but they're not good enough. If the Apple store was just a nice place to buy because it's a pretty environment, it wouldn't have transformed retail like it has. You wouldn't be doing $7,000 a square foot or 35 times the average square foot at a department store. So we've got to do much, much more. And one of the great pleasures I've had in my life is to work with really great people. Michael Graves is here, and Michael and I got to work at Target. Let's hear it for Michael. And we did some neat things. Working at Apple was a wonderful thing. And now we've got a chance to work with someone who is just part of the fabric of America. And here's a picture of her at age 5. And this was taken right across the Hudson over in Nutley, New Jersey. Most of us got to know this person when she became a model. I wish I knew her then, but I didn't. And it turns out this is when this person was about 16 years old. But we all know her today as Martha Stewart. And we are so excited to have a partnership with Martha. And we are going to do some incredible things, because Martha has been the authority for home in the United States for a number of years. We turn to her television show. We turn to her website when we have advice. But when we buy our products, it's an independent experience. You can't even buy the products online from Martha Stewart. Now, that's kind of a disconnect in a digital world where everything has gone to multi-channel. So we're going to take the partnership with Martha and put in a Martha Stewart store inside JCPenney so we can truly bring to life Martha Stewart. And people will connect with the idea of Martha Stewart and how to improve your home in ways they've never imagined in a retail store, right? You'll be able to come in before you're ready to buy to learn about things. You'll be able to come when it's time to buy. You'll be able to come in afterward to learn how to use the tools that you bought. This is a comprehensive strategy. Imagine the Apple Store for technology married with Martha Stewart. And it's going to be unbelievable. And we've got these Martha Stewart store under development. We're very excited about it. It'll roll out 1 year from today. But we're really fortunate that Martha's here, and I'd like to invite her up on the stage briefly to say a few words. So,
thank you very much. Well, I do have a few comments that I'd like to make, and thank you, Ron, for inviting me to share in your excitement today. I have long been an admirer of both Ron Johnson and Michael Francis, although I did not meet them in person until last year. And with every single meeting, my admiration for them has grown. Both men exude a really serious yet playful enthusiasm when describing a creative concept, a strategic business idea, or even a vast plan to change the future. What a tutorial you've treated us to today. Thank you very much, both of you. It's really fantastic. And both men exhibit an entrepreneurial initiative in a most attractive way. And that is really what prompted me to want to work with them to build a new forward-thinking retail business that would change the way we all shop for all the everyday things that we need and want. Ron offered MSLO several exciting opportunities, and one is the ability to build hundreds of Martha Stewart stores within hundreds of JCPenney's. And the other very exciting one is the ability to build our own Martha Stewart online stores where we could easily sell and efficiently sell the many, many thousands of diverse Martha Stewart products, from the finest craft tools and materials to all sorts of amazing products for the home, for celebrations, weddings, baby births, baby birthdays, family birthdays, and every single rite of passage. And for your pets, for backyards, for basements and attics, for desks and offices, and even laundry rooms and kitchen pantries. Ron recognized and understood that the Martha brand would fit tidily into his gigantic scheme. And I and everyone who works at Martha Stewart Living Omnimedia shares his deep-seated belief that the customer needs and wants quality products, fairly priced, carefully constructed, beautifully designed and edited. He also values content and the integration of clear, descriptive how-to, trustworthy instructions and step-by-step recipes to enable customers to live better, to cook better, to decorate better, and to celebrate more effusively. It's really a great, great pleasure to be part of the fabulous house that Ron and Michael and the rest of the wonderful JCPenney team are building, and we look forward to the excitement of the next couple years as we develop and invent together the future of retailing. It's great. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Now, you can just start to put together in your mind what a monthly cadence means with a partner like Martha. When it's July and it's time to plan your picnic, you can come to the store. And we're all about food and celebrating July. And every month, food changes, the foods we use, the things we drink. And now as we pull that together, it'll be an incredibly interesting place to come visit. And so this Martha Stewart store is going to be pretty profound. So now you've got a glimpse of shops. You've got a flavor of the types of shops. And you've learned that it's going to be relentless. Starting August 1st, two shops a month for 3.5 years. That's going to create a better store. But we think we can do even better. Because ultimately, for the retail store to win in a digital world, it's got to do things that can't happen online or on your phone or on your iPad, right? So we have been working hard designing an entirely new prototype for JCPenney, and I'll give you a quick peek into that. It's heavily informed by the work that we did together at Apple. And I think Apple can afford me to tell you this, but let me tell you the secret to the Apple store design. It's really simple, but the store is separated into two equal halves. One is called the red zone, and one is called the family room. The red zone is where you come to discover new products, right? That's where the excitement is. If you're at Soho, it's the ground floor. The family room is where owners gather to learn more, right? So it's products and services. And the magic of the store that makes everyone want to come is all the stuff you get beyond the transaction. Because at Apple, the relationship doesn't end when you buy, that's where it begins. And we're gonna do that at JCPenney, right? Now, the way we think about it is if this is a single floor JCPenney store, obviously it starts with 100 shops, right? We'll have 100 shops that you can go work in. But we thought it was time to update the traditional center core of a department store. Why for 100 years does center core have to be jewelry, accessories, cosmetics? Maybe it's time to move that out of the center and put it where it belongs on Main Street. So our store will have two components. Main Street goes back to our heritage where the shops are, and we're putting in something brand new called Town Square. Town Square will become the new center core of JCPenney. Now, Town Square doesn't sell products. Town Square makes the experience better. And it's a place you'll visit before you want to buy. It'll be a place that'll make when you buy substantially more interesting and better. It'll be a place that you want to come back to, right? And so people will come just to come, just like you go to the Apple store. But every time you get to Town Square, what do you have to do? You got to walk through Main Street. And every time you walk through Main Street, you're going to discover something new because our shops change every month and the ideas change every month. Now, I'd love to tell you more about Town Square, but we're going to keep it under wraps because there's a lot of very interesting original thinking here, but we will actually debut Town Square in 2013 at a Penny store, hopefully near you. All right? So, what have we seen today? We said we're going to rethink everything, and we've done that, right? We changed our personality with an all-new corporate identity, an all-new logo, et cetera. We've rolled out a new pricing strategy, which we call Fair and Square. We have changed our promotional strategy to monthly with all new materials and books at $80 million a month. We've got the start on substantial changes in our merchandise. And you'll see those in the store today, but you'll see those accelerate rapidly as we move through the year toward the fall. You've seen a presentation strategy that moves the entire store from endless Caesar racks to shops. And you've heard a beginning glimpse into an all-new store design, right? There's a lot going on here. As Walter said, if you fix one of the P's, you might have a good business. You get two right, you're going to be really profitable. We are not here to improve. We're here to transform. And we got to change it all. And that's what we're going to do. And it starts next week. February 1st, we changed three of the core and essential elements of our retail strategy. Beginning in spring, you'll see dramatic improvements to products. You'll see it through the signing going away, the editing, the natural good work the buyers have done. You'll see shops start to roll out on August 1st, and they'll continue, as I said, for 3.5 years. And in 2013, we will launch Town Square. In 2014, in February, we'll launch our whole new prototype. And by 2015, every one of our stores will be completely transformed. So in the time it takes for your son or daughter to complete their college education, 4 years, we will have transformed JCPenney. That's the blueprint, you know? And what I learned at Apple is nothing happens overnight. It only feels that way. But the fun thing about work is that every journey begins with the first step. And each step informs the next. You know, at Apple, it was interesting to go from a Mac to an iPod. And the iPod created a halo for the Mac, and then a phone, and the phone helped the whole ecosystem, and then the iPad. And Apple has succeeded through a relentless flow of new products, and the business has gotten bigger and bigger. Well, that's what we're gonna do at JCPenney, but we're gonna relentlessly introduce new products month by month, starting in August, and we're gonna get momentum for this brand unlike any retail store that's ever happened. Now, will we become America's favorite store? Only time will tell. But I walk here today being highly confident I can get at least you two to come to Penny's next year. And if you do, that's a 10% same-store sale. And if somehow we get one of these rows, you know, we can double the business. And I think this is an extraordinary opportunity. And so February 1st, we start, and then we start moving forward. And for us to succeed, we're going to need all the partners in the world. The Penny's team, and I know they're on board, and they've been unbelievable. Our vendor partners, our advertising partners, but we want everyone who loves creativity and loves merchandise to come help us out, because we truly want to be America's favorite store. And it's not going to happen overnight, but I really do believe it'll happen. So thank you for coming, and we really appreciate you being part of our presentation today.
Control.